7. All right, special program today, Friday morning. Joining us, David Bahnsen, Gary Kaltbaum. May we call this the all-star team?
Oh, yeah.
You may.
Yes, if you include Susan Lee and Ashley Webster. The all-stars are assembled. The China slowdown, let's start there. David, it clearly is slowing down. Industrial production actually falling, for heaven's sake. Does that affect our stocks?
Well, it does, and in two different ways. For one thing, their slowdown is what they're admitting to, which means it's even worse. Right. I mean, the data is always a little soft-pedaled. And if this is what they're saying it is, you go, geez, I wonder if they're really more 5.5 GDP print. But the fact of the matter is, it affects all of us, even guys that have no China exposure like me, because it increases volatility.
It
increases the risk premium in the market. Now, fundamentally, depending on how this trade war stuff plays out, I think this is a great opportunity for U.S. investors that are seeing a downtick in stocks that don't have direct China exposure just because they're caught up in the whole dropping tide, so to speak. But I would say that China's story is going to get worse before it gets better.
Okay. Gary Kaltbaum, China's slowing down, effect on our stocks.
Of course. You know,
what effect?
First off, Chinese ADRs are down, Alibaba and the rest are down 30, 40, 50%. That's for starters. But if China's slowing down, potentially that means other places are slowing down. If other places are slowing down, we slow down. If we slow down, then, and you may be seeing some of it in the market right now. I think you're getting a little bit here.
Do you think the Alibabas of this world, Chinese tech stocks, are a buying opportunity now?
No, because all I see on a daily basis is heavy volume selling. I need to see something different. The complexion first has to change a little bit.
It's funny because JP Morgan says that all of this right now is all about technical sell-off, and the problem is that there's a blackout period for stock buybacks, and as the earnings season progresses, those blackouts come off, and there's going to be a huge surge in big company buyback of shares, and that's going to really start pushing the markets higher, especially given the sell-off.
Buybacks are not as big as the big institutions selling off stock that they've had for a long time. They can buy back all the stock they want.
But it will stem the flow.
I think it's true that the lack of buybacks is really the source of the problem. I don't think it's a big, as Gary says, it's not a big enough percentage of volume. But think about what that says if it were true, that we're that dependent on share buybacks.
Well, there are those that say we have been,
because it's the big companies that have been the big share buyers this year, and hence the stock markets are up. If we didn't have institutions buying back their shares, we might not even be at.
And buybacks have a negative thing. GE's been buying back their stock since $50.
IBM, they're not all
gentlemen. We're not. Quiet on the set. We're not technicians on this program. We don't use jargon. I'm going to ask you, Gary Kaltbaum, about the big techs. Put them up on the screen, please. I think they're all up this morning. By the way, Amazon, Alphabet, Microsoft, they report their earnings next week. But Gary, you wouldn't buy them. You wouldn't buy any of them, would you?
Not yet. It just seems to me that we have a pretty darn good top in place right now. On a daily basis, I'm seeing heavy selling. And notice Netflix. Up 30 on great earnings within a day, everything given back. That tells you the state of the market right now. And look, I think some of these companies are going to report great numbers. I am dubious on whether we're going to get a good pop out of them from here. And I think that we got some more time and price right now.
Okay, so not buying yet.
Not yet.
You want to see them go down some more. Then you might dip your toe in the
water. Now, why is that? Because I have to say that the S&P, the P.E. ratio for 2019 forward earnings, the price to earnings, cheap or in line 16 times.
But that's S&P.
The long-term
you're asking about
average.
Tech, and tech is way above the S&P. And some ridiculously above.
You know, you're getting away with murder this morning, Susan. You're waving your finger around and you're using this. Thank you. P.E. ratio?
She defined it. But let's address that, because his point about the sucker play on Netflix the other day, up $30 on a headline, what was their P.E. ratio? 180. Yeah. Okay, and so here's the point I would make, though. We're talking about a top in these. Facebook's at 150. It was at 220.
Right.
They're well off of it.
Well off.
I think that Netflix and now Amazon have to come back to a reality. Would I dip my toe in? It depends where the drop is. The one exception is all these stocks get lumped together. Apple does not belong in that list.
Yeah.
Apple's trading at 15 times forward. They need to raise the dividend. That's the issue with
Microsoft
Apple.
Does not belong.
No, although they're a pricey stock, too.
Nonsense. moving on to Tesla. Now they say, now they're going to produce the Model 3 for $35,000.
I don't know. Okay, so that's $35,000 after tax rebates, $45,000 base price. But the only cars they've been building for the Model 3 has been the Premium Edition, which starts at $64,000 before options. But don't forget, those tax rebates expire in January. They don't expect to deliver these cheaper Model 3s for another 4 months.
I don't understand the announcement and the fact that they can't even fill their other orders the other 3s. I don't get it. This is somewhat of a joke in that part of business is you got to produce the product.
But it's a Teflon stock. Oh, look at all
not
negatives.
Not recently,
smoke and mirrors, and we know what kind of smoke.
But 265. No,
but just remember,
a Teflon stock that's down 40%.
But Tesla's also lived off of easy money and high stock price to do secondaries and low bond yield. So we'll see how that.
I was just glad that there was an announcement that wasn't something completely unrelated
to the company. Yeah.
All right, let's move on quickly, please. A rosy forecast from American Express, and I think investors like it. Well, we're up 106 on the Dow. Show me American Express. They did give a rosy forecast for the future. Mm. Nice gain, 3%. And a big stock like that, 3% is a solid gain. But even better, Procter & Gamble. They make everything in your supermarket. They stock virtually the entire supermarket. Mm. Wow. Detergent, toothpaste, you name it, they got it. They came in with a strong earnings report early this morning. They're up nearly 7%. What would you say, Justin? Okay. Procter & Gamble is a Dow stock. The big gain in Procter & Gamble adds 60 points and Amex
exactly
together
half of the gain
give you an extra 60 points. Yeah. Half the gain is two stocks.
Right.
Look at oil, $69 a barrel. Oh, look at the average price for gas. I thought it was well on the way to $3 a gallon, but it's slipping. This morning we're down to $2.86. Got it. Here's something that's interesting. Amazon teaming up with Sirius. So Alexa, Alexa, play me this, can play your satellite radio music for you. I think that's a pretty good idea, isn't it?
It's a great move. There's a reason why they bought Pandora, get into the pay-per-music. But the big story for me is two words, and that's Baba Booey. Howard Stern is still around. He is the driving force behind Sirius. And you get this, you get him moved out to just away from, stay with cars, but also into the home. And I think it's going to work wonders.
What are you talking about?
Baba Booey.
Howard Stern.
You think he's the mainstay of Sirius XM satellite radio?
Oh, absolutely.
Don't you know that they've got a Beatles channel?
Listen, I know, but the main force behind Sirius going from here up to here was Howard Stern.
To me, it's Fox Business, Stuart.
And Fox Business, of course. Channel 113.
Had to help him out there.
Well played.
But seriously, if you can now put your Alexa and you get XM satellite on your Alexa.
Yes.
Does Amazon get some money out of that?
I don't think it helps.
No, they get no revenue from it whatsoever.
They don't need it. You think Amazon needs 110?
Right, who needs revenue?
Why would they turn it down? What's the advantage to Amazon?
There is no advantage for Amazon, I think. I think it's more beneficial for Sirius and Pandora, which they just merge into.
I mean, there is makes the Alexa product more buyable, but it's not a needle mover.
There's nothing wrong with partnership and brand recognition here and over here. Nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
No downside.
I'm surrounded by starry-eyed liberals. Oh, no, we don't want any more revenue.
I have never been accused of being a liberal.
Excuse me.
You can call me a lot of things.
Okay. All right. Apple, big event at the end of the month, rolling out new devices, I'm told.
Overselling it. It's not a big event. You think AirPods and iPads matter anymore to a company that gets 3/4 of their revenue from a phone? No.
Okay, $219 is the price of the stock. That's one stock. That has not one tech stock, as you say. It's not. It doesn't belong with the others.
No,
it hasn't come down anything like the others. That's a fact.
It's really not a new tech company anymore. It's very old tech.
Didn't somebody predict $240 a share by the end of this year
on
Apple? I think we got that yesterday. I think we did anyway. Yeah, you know, look, I mean, the all-stars have to come to an end at some point, and it's now 9:40 Eastern time. You're done, Kaltbaum, but have a good time with your dad tonight at his birthday party.
87th birthday for Herb. We are proud.
Oh, that's
a great thing.
Yes. And David, you're totally wrong about the lottery, but that's another story entirely.
You live in a crisis of responsibility, Stuart.
Oh, all right, okay. Thank you, David.